I'll comment on what is called a meta commentary. A lot of comments have happened, particularly last hour or so, that have been here. I have heard a couple of people, largely Rajiv Malhotra ji. So now, what should I say? I want to tell you that, of course, a lot of what Rajiv Malhotra ji and his friends and colleagues and companions are doing, of course, is a wonderful service to Indian understanding of our own civilization, our own philosophy, literature. It's no gain saying that, of course, Bendy Doniger, as the author, Meera herself, himself, I don't know if it is female or male, says, is a formidable scholar without any doubt in her own right. You and I may have a disagreement on the methodology and, of course, the attitude and the presuppositions that the scholar Bendy Doniger may have when she constructs her story based on the text that she reads in Sanskrit, whether it is the Vedic text, Puranic text, or even other texts. Now, that is one part. As you might have heard in the during the day, and certainly you must have heard what Rajiv Malhotra ji said, that we need to learn the methodology of reading texts which is already there in our tradition. We do not have to borrow any methodology from anywhere. But I also say that there is nothing wrong in understanding what others are saying. You have to know what the Western authors, both those that are writing on India and those that are not writing on India, they're writing their own stuff. So I can say that you can have Wendy Doniger, you can have Schopenhauer, you can have Hegel, you can have many other scholars who are, or Max Müller for that matter, many of them. And modern scholars about whom Rajiv Malhotra ji has spent decades decoding their idea of understanding India, as I call it, whether it is Sheldon Pollock, Bendy Doniger, or many others. So we need to understand what they are trying to say, reflecting upon the literature that they use to craft their stories. So Darshan ji was trying to explain an Indian mind, of course, who is very much in the league of the Western scholars. So he somehow flies out spiritually abroad and then looks at India and then tries to craft his narrative, his story. Very popular historian of modern time, we like it or not. We disagree, of course, that is true. But whether we have written a tome that he has written, that is a more important part we need to be concerned about. That is one part. As I said, whether it is Sheldon Pollock or Wendy Doniger, I am one of those who have for a few decades been engaged in trying to understand them. I have had my education in that part of the world. So I know the travails as well as the labyrinths of working in that system. That is one part. But as often you might have read in many other books and articles that Malhotra ji and his companions, Divya ji sitting here, is that you need to know your opponent to be able to craft your defense. It's a very straightforward technique. Let me put to you how we from our ancient texts and traditions have got a very basic and a powerful idea to discuss any philosophical, religious, literary theories or even the meaning from them. And India being a place where I cannot think of any other civilization which has developed a most wonderful system of storing knowledge. And that is sutra system. I can't think of any. I'm not including mathematical sutras, but those who are studying in this area would find perhaps that is there. Two, imagine how the Vedic system, the Vedic texts are being understood, recited, chanted, used for our daily lives, for our future lives, if you like. And then on the basis of that, you find a second set of texts, which are the Brahmanas, Brahmana texts. Much is being made about Brahmins and Brahmans. There's a lot of confusion among those, even those who know Sanskrit well enough to be able to differentiate between Brahmana and Brahmin. Brahmin being an Anglicized version of a person who might have been born in a certain social structure of India. Brahmanas are the texts which are considered to be the heart of the interpretation of the rituals that one uses to understand and use the Vedas. Let's say Rig Veda. So the Rig Veda, of course, Rig Veda is only one text. But we also have three Vedas with it, which are a remarkable system of building your knowledge. Yajurveda, Atharva Veda, and Sama Veda. The other three Vedas, they're not auxiliary to the Rig Veda, but without them, the Rig Veda will be difficult to appreciate, and the vice versa. That is the system with which we function in our knowledge system. The Brahmana text's job is actually to explain what the Vedas are trying to communicate, what the Vedic verses, mantras, words, even syllables at times, because even syllables are important. Some of you might have heard that even missing out a syllable can cause a massive, massive catastrophe. Just as it happens, you say the same word, use the same word that we normally do in our daily life. Somebody has misunderstood and you really have to say, really, I did not mean that. I don't know what you mean by that. But of course, you know that you didn't mean that, but it has been so understood. So there is a sort of story which goes about how careful we should be in handling our texts. And that is, mantro heenah swarato varnatova. If a mantra of the Veda is corrupted, heenah swaratah varnatah, either in articulation or in its syllables. Once it is used, recited, so there is a greater emphasis in a society where you speak the knowledge out and others have to lap it up through their auditory perceptions and then store it for them later on to process it and then articulate it further. That this three-stage process is remarkable when you look at the Vedic texts. Mantrohinah swaratah varnatahava mithya prayuktah. Or if you use it in an inappropriate place where it is not required. Or another meaning is, if it is spoken wrongly. Na tamarthamaha does not convey the meaning that you desire it to convey. And the example is remarkable. It becomes an Indra Vajra. Yathendra Vajro Swarato Paradhat. That particular word, if it is spoken wrongly, and the example is given, I'm giving you the how little syllable when you articulate, if it is wrongly articulated, can cause catastrophe. Indra Shatruhu Vardhaswa literally could mean, if you use the compound in Sanskrit, one is Indra who Shatru X is, may Indra who Shatru X is prosper. Or may Indra Shatru prosper. Now, Vrittasura, of course, was performing yajna, where the priest simply said, and this is the way we are, somehow composing the mantra to perform the ritual, where you will be gaining power over Indra and you will defeat Indra. Somehow, the priest who was chanting the mantra for Vritta either did not know or did it deliberately, we do not know. When you say Indra Shatruhu Vardhaswa, it simply, there is an emphasis on all of Sha, then it would simply mean a Shashti Tatpurus, the enemy of Indra, that is Vritta, straightforward. When you say Indra Shatruhu Vardhasva, it will be a different compound. Indra, whose enemy Vritta is, may prosper. So Indra will prosper. So the entire yajna is performed. This is said in a lighter vein to frighten people not to take the articulation of the text lightly. That is the objective. And so the entire yajna was performed, and naturally all the benefits of the yajna went to Indra. How could Vritta win? So this is the warning that is given. It's called dharma. The dharma is used, the duty is used, that you do not try and make a mistake in behaving in a certain way that is given to you. So that is one thing. So sutra, therefore, to me becomes an important Brahmana text, and then Aranyaka comes the next text, and then come Upanishads. Now these four stages of text, the construction of the knowledge system, or Indian, ancient Indian knowledge system, is so beautifully done that by the time you reach that age of Upanishads, you have matured completely. Now, it doesn't mean that it is happening over the centuries. All of it can happen at once. That is my understanding. You have a proliferation of certain set of texts, yes, but it doesn't mean when the Vedas are in absolute tradition and fashion, I'm not going to use the word vogue, then the Upanishads or Aranyaka and Veda, Brahmana texts, are not really being constructed or composed or written. When I say written, I make a difference between written and written down. That's what it is. So they are written, but obviously the ancient Indian seers never bothered about copyright. So therefore, and they became, as I often say, the nightmare for those who study ancient Indian history. Now that this is why, but they also left lot of clues, if you wanted to pick them up, lot of points to understand. They leave lot of hints. So when the second stage comes, what do we do with these four sets of texts? You then have to devise a method where there has to be a master, certainly, and there has to be somebody who has mastered it, and then those of us who want to learn it. That tradition needed to be codified, and they gave these code words. Now, these code words are not gibberish or gobbledygook. They had meanings. So the mantra was devised. Every system of Indian philosophy then begins with a particular sutra. There could be the variation in the number of sutras, so much so that even Panini, when he was trying to codify grammar in the 5th century BC, or maybe a little earlier, I believe, he resorted to this fact that it is difficult for people immediately to memorize everything. One sutra, therefore, becomes a hook on which you hang various kinds of knowledges, which takes me to this next stage of storing or preserving or proliferating knowledge, and that is the interpretation. It is the interpretation, the stage of interpretation, that most of us, we don't even go beyond that. We can't go to the sutras. We are busy with interpretation. So sutra, as it is said, it is a capsule of knowledge, or in computer language you can say a zip file, or even a code word. Suddenly the files open. The sutra cannot be understood without a very admirable system of knowledge preservation and proliferation that is called Vada, debate system. And which is what Sudarshanji was referring to, that you can, if you want to have a debate with X, a scholar with whom you have a fundamental difference on various things, you need to know what they are saying, where they are coming from, what is their inspiration for that matter. And I never discount prejudice or presupposition. I am fully prejudiced when I say I don't agree with that. So when you are interpreting, I cannot believe that you can be objective with knowledge. Yes, perhaps to a large degree you could be objective. Because once you're objective, you have left out a major chunk of the system of preserving knowledge that is called aesthetics. Rajiji was talking about aestheticization of power or knowledge. That's a different area. It's a good discipline. We can debate some other time. But the Vada system, and it is in the Vada system that the Acharya said, there are three stages. One is a Vada is absolutely essential because on the truth, or what we call in logic T, you have from P to T you have to reach. So the T has to be agreed upon two or more parties who have a difference on that. That is Vada. Where eventually after debating you agree that T is T, this truth, whatever it is. From P, that is proposition. But the second, they said, what you should really be wary of, and which is what I am wary of. And I forgive me if I am, you know, hinting at something that you do not like, is Jalpa. Jalpa is another tradition where both sides want to win either by hook or by crook. It doesn't matter. Both of them are skilled debaters, skilled conversationists. Not as good as Krishna, in my opinion, the conversationist. But they would say, no, they are right. So they have to prove, in other words, they have to find a fault with the opponent in order to score the point. The Acharya says, Jalpa should be used only to learn how to debate, not actually to conclude the debate. And Vitanda, the third part is, this is, I'm talking about from Indian logic and Mimamsa also, is something that neither of them is interested in what the truth is. They just want to defeat the other, defeat the other's point. So therefore, they said, Vada, Sutra, Vada, and the third is, as I said, interpretation where we are mostly, I don't think we have ever reached anywhere beyond even a fraction of interpretation, Vyakhya. Therefore, you have six or seven categories of Vyakhya or commentary. You can have Mahabhashya, you can have Bhashya, you can have a Vritti, you can have Prakarna, you can have Karika, multiple layers, and all of them, whether you might be offended, I might be offended today, why am I being categorized as a person who can't understand beyond this? But as teachers, we know what is the, we need to guess what the level of the audience is to speak in that sense. Therefore, you decide which student, which group of students requires which much of, how much of interpretation of a particular knowledge system. Once we do that, then probably we shall be able to come to a conclusion where the business of what we call those of us who are in the business of knowledge, I do believe knowledge is business. Because I also believe knowledge is a commodity. Even from a logical point of view, you can prove it, that it is pragya, so it is a commodity which is owned by somebody. You can share it. There could be the same pragya between Sudarshanji and me, but both of us own in our own way that particular pragya or knowledge. So once the knowledge is commodity, therefore, in order to preserve that knowledge, what Sudarshanji and others are doing is extremely important to figure out, to filter out what actually is being thrown. This is what, as I said, Wendy Doniger, an extremely accomplished writer who can influence through the logic the same verse of, say, Manusmriti or a Purana or even the Bhagavad Gita. These are the texts that she has translated. You could see how she would translate, how you and I might translate a particular verse from the Bhagavad Gita. When somebody says, what is the sthita pragya? A person who knows enough Sanskrit to translate into their own languages, in this case, English, mother tongue, father tongue, whatever it is, then you can translate sthita pragya in this way. Or you and I, learning through the system of our tradition, can understand what sthita pragya is. Then we can interpret what is the tortoise in that particular verse in the Bhagavad Gita? How does that tortoise withdraw its limbs into the shell at a time when everybody else might be dancing about a particular aspect? So in that sense, we really need to first understand and read what our systems are all about, what they are communicating and then follow the theories and exhaust whatever has been done so far. If we do that, for example, even in Mimamsa. Now, Mimamsa, there is a particular mantra, there are four or five kinds of statements that we find in the Vedas. The later Acharya says, Vidhi, Nisheda, Arthavada, etc. So what is the example of Arthavada that a Mimamsa writer will give? Varhishi Rajatam Nadeyam. One should never give silver as a gift in a particular ritual. Now this is a, say, Vedic statement. One should never gift silver, pure silver, as a gift in any sacred ritual. For example, if you're marrying off your daughter or whatever it is. Then Mimamsakara comes along to explain why it is. And this is what I call dharma. And Mimamsa Nyaya Prakash says, So arodit yara rodit tad ruddhasya rudratvam varhishi rajat. Rajat, another name is Rudra. The silver are the tears of Varuna. And there is a long story, I don't want to get into that. And therefore, because it is the tears of Varuna, you should never gift pure silver to a particular, in any ritual. That is one aspect of a Mimamsa interpretation, how a particular mantra, how a particular word holds relevance. And final point that I would like to say, that in India, when I told you that the fourth stage of the Vedic knowledge system reaches to the Upanishads, what are the Upanishads? A simple conversation. Pick up any Upanishad. It begins with the most simple conversation between two people. It could be father and son in the case of Nachiketas and the Mrityu or Nachiketa. It could be Gargi and Maitreyi with their husband, Yajnavalkya. Or it could be the father and son elsewhere, student and teacher elsewhere. Very simple. Pick up the opening of any Upanishad. What is happening in Yajnavalkya, in the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad? Yajnavalkya is telling his wife, here it is, I have established a beautiful university. It is very popular. Lots of teachers, students are coming to study here. You both are very accomplished teachers. Go ahead and run it. I am now off to my fourth stage. Fulfilled my life. The wife has the right to hold her husband by the scruff of the neck and say, hold on, just answer my question that I have in my mind and then you can go off. And thank God she did ask the question, otherwise we won't have Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. She asks, the objective of knowledge is to attain sukha. Will I be sukhi? Sukhi bhavishyami. Will I be sukhi, happy, if I had the wealth of the entire universe? Why did Maitri or Gagi ask about the wealth? Because that is the most visible part of, if Rajiv Malhotra didn't have that kind of money in Infinity Foundation, will we be here? Or if somebody doesn't donate. So the wealth therefore becomes very important. That's a very visible part of the source of pleasure and happiness. And the response is very cute from Yajnavalkya. No, my dear, you will be as happy as the richest people of the world. But if you really want to have what you call the real happiness, then atma avare drishtabhyah shrotabhyah mantavyah nididhyasitabhyah. Look within. The look within in the house of happiness. Happiness as if it comes from outside and we consume it. So happiness, sukha, is a commodity or consumable item which we consume. And Yajnavalkya said that if you explore your atma, then probably you will find what the real sukha is. The other, as I gave you an example of a conversation, these are simple. You could convert this conversation in a family at the end of the month, say yesterday or last week. There's a last week, how are we going to manage our last week? Those of us who are salaried people I'm talking about, not Rajiv Malhotra. So how are we going to manage the last week? This is a simple conversation. It moves up to a very high level of conversation. So as long as we look at this literature that this is a highly meditated set of texts, and we try and understand them as they were written, but of course, keeping the modern context in mind. Otherwise, this is not useful at all. So, how do we make it more modern, more contemporary, topical, whichever the word you want to pick up? Then our job will be done, rather than only focusing what others have done that is wrong. How are we going to correct it? Thank you.